I am Mary Lou Houllis, spiritual leader of a community in Tarpon Springs, Florida called New Beginning Oneness Center. And tonight I am going to interview a man who is clearly on a profound mission, a former rock musician and artist, and an inspirational leader who is really helping humanity step out of the old paradigm into something really new by pulling back the veils for us and who is really controlling our world and the game that's going on. And he first established something called Humanitad in 1999. And now, about 15 years later, he established something called New Earth Nation, which is a profound movement which is dedicated to human sovereignty and consciousness through self-sustaining communities. He's an outspoken advocate on human rights and natural justice. And Sasha, I want to say, I'm going to introduce Sasha Stone, but I want to say the speech that you gave to the international leadership in 2012 moved me so much. We have played it a few times for our community, and I think it's one of the most articulate, profound speeches that I've ever heard. And if you people that are listening haven't heard it, go to YouTube and listen to it, because it's really, I don't think Sasha missed one thing that all of us wouldn't like to address to our world leaders. So right now, I would like to introduce Sasha Stone. Hi, Sasha. How are you?
Delightful to be with you. I'm sitting here in Bali, just so you know, in the jungles of Bali with a rice farmer not too far from me with a chainsaw, which I can hear rather loudly, but apparently you're not hearing. So hopefully we can struggle through this.
Sasha, when I was thinking about interviewing you, I was thinking about, I feel like people would like to really know, what is Sasha Stone's passion? And how did you begin this journey that has brought you where you are today? Could you kind of fill us in on that?
Where is the distinction between, on the line between the being and the doing? And I have to say that increasingly there's become less and less of a division between the two. So I know that I'm one of those souls who has been lucky enough, blessed enough in life to be able to stand back from the madding crowd, so to speak, not have to engage in doing a job to pay the bills. Not that I'm wealthy, but I've just been a good hustler. And I've been able to navigate my way through life without becoming indentured to the man. And that was something visceral in myself, just an absolute intrinsic contempt for the harvest wheel, for the business of having to put my energy, my time, my attention, my plasma toward somebody else's agenda, working for the man. And because I elected very early in life not to participate in that cycle and find a way, any way, to navigate around that, it's enabled me the luxury of synthesizing the business of being and the business of doing into one. The business of doing relates to time.
Yes.
Relates to fear and desire. And the business of being relates to space. Relates to the vertical axis as opposed to the lateral axis. Where we're able to synthesize being and doing into the same quanta, I believe that this is absolutely where we begin to tap in to the what I call the superconscious. And this to me has become my singular pursuit, being able to bear witness to unfoldment without moving towards an object or moving away from an object, becoming witness to the ineffable magic and majesty of who and what we all are in the now. I hope that's not too esoteric. It makes a great deal of sense to me.
It's beautiful. It's really, you know, escaping the illusion, isn't it? And really tapping into the reality of who we, our beingness is. And I love the way you put that. But what I'd like to know is, how did this journey begin for you? What was the catalyst that began to awaken Sasha Stone?
I'm not sure how to answer that. My background is a war zone in Africa, and then becoming a dissolute poet, rock and roll musician, and really engaging my primal scream that way. And once I'd done that to my own satisfaction, I determined to get into the mud and start to shape it. Again, a very healthy contempt for authority, a very healthy contempt for the imposition of authority, which is the blessing that came from a childhood which was largely terrorized by systems and thought forms and enclosures because of the very patriarchal, militaristic environment within which I grew up. It taught me a healthy contempt for imposed authority. But at the same time, I think I've been grounded by family, certainly by my mother, in understanding my P's and Q's and learning how to navigate through life, really using intelligence and not brute force. So that certainly helped. And in the main, just my own capacity to engage time as art as opposed to time as money, which is the false light paradigm that the world has been indentured into, believing that time is money. This comes from the great sage, José Arguelles, who I was blessed to know and love as a friend before he died. The man who, as you may well know, really put the 2012 meme into the field by virtue of the extraordinary works that he did. But he was the one who codified that time as art, not as money. But certainly I've lived that expression since I was a teenager. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, beautiful, beautiful. Well, to a person who maybe has never heard about New Earth Nation, and we're hoping that we really bring that to the surface today, how would you describe it and your vision for New Earth Nation, Sasha?
New Earth Nation is the collective vision of New Earth Nation, not of Sasha Stone. So there's a huge distinction there. My vision is one of what I call zero point expression, in as much as we begin afresh every quantum instant. We forget everything we think we know. We do not conduct lives according to the law of first report. We don't carry baggage in from the past into the so-called future. By definition, that means we recognize that there is no past and no future. They are ultimately a tremendous fiction. And beautiful. To the extent to which we are able to stand within that flame of pure truth in the now and engage absolute expression, take full accountability for who and what we are, and engage the super soul in the now, this is where and how we are enabled to fulfill our truest potential, which is to act as the living organic technology, Homo sapiens sapien, that is able and mandated to imprint the patterns of perfection into this temporal plane. We are heaven on earth once we recognize that that is our propensity, that we are the conduit to manifest all that is righteous, all that is beautiful, all that is timeless. But we have to step outside of the fiction of the interposed reality before we can manifest, become manifestors. And this is why we need to apprehend our own journey and stop buying into the fiction of our false reality. I call it Luciferianism, because Luciferianism by definition is false light worship. And false light does not mean the devil outside. False light means the wrong actions that issue from me, the wrong thought forms that issue from within me, my own incapacity to engage pure expression within actuated self. So it all speaks to pure truth. It all speaks to one's ability or inability to engage fully one's potential in the here and now. People who are understanding this metric of full autonomous expression and creative expansion and sovereignty and consciousness in action and time as art, not as money, all of that metric, that language, where that speaks to people, they are by definition the New Earth Nationals anyway, whether they sign the treaty or not, whether they engage this movement or not is immaterial. But that the New Earth Nation speaks to the emerging a supranation of peoples, organic living men and women of the living soil all around the earth that are no longer indentured to the fictitious corporations masquerading as government, or indentured to the fictitious realms of religious idolatry or cultural idolatry or intellectual hubris. All of those things are fictions. The only things that are real in this world are human beings and the land, the living soil and the living men and women of the land. And the sooner we get back to that innate recognition of that which is real, as opposed to the fictitious reality that has been dreamt up by generations of myopia and dystopia, the sooner the better, because everything is right here, right now. All the patterns of perfection. We know enough from the quantum realm in advanced quantum mechanics to know that we affect the outcome wherever we place our attention. So let's place our attention not on manifesting wars and blood economy and hierarchical structures and systems, which only serve invisible priesthoods and ancient kingly lines. Let's instead look to one another, stand in a circle, better still sit in a circle, and begin to engage the living flame of Homo sapien, and then manifest the world that we truly want to live in. Almost instantly, it will manifest. Those concrete landscapes of tenement buildings in Moscow and Johannesburg and Tel Aviv and Addis Ababa, they don't actually exist in the truest realm of expression. They are mutant, low vibrational expressions of dense matter that we have permissioned into manifestation through wrong action and wrong attention. Let's remove our action and our attention from that dystopia into the other, the new earth nation, and the blueprints and templates that we have put out into the world and increasingly are putting out into the world speak to that new landscape, speak to the new vista, not one based on woolly philosophy and new age prognostications, but a new world based on that which we can tangibly deliver on ourselves without seeking permission from so-called authorities. In fact, the sooner we completely enter our fiction governments and fiction religious and cultural myths into the dissolution, the better. Actually, that is when we would be living out the mandate of the Buddha, of the Krishna, of the Master Jesus, of the Prophet Muhammad. And so it goes on. You see what I mean by intellectual hubris? We keep growing this hubris. Each generation, each civilizational wheel dreams into manifestation a new aggregate of wrong thought forms, wrong elemental clouds, and they become accreted into the physical realm. That then strangles us and destroys us. So let's just stop that endless incarnatory cycle and instead just go into that zero point space. That's what the new earth is. And Mary Lou, to answer your question in my usual roundabout way, the new earth nation emerges now in the hearts and minds of people who are understanding the distinction between the fictitious and the organic living.
Beautiful. You answered really a question that I was going to pose a little further on. We have a community in Tarpon Springs called New Beginning Oneness Center, where we're really, you know, talking about our connectedness and withdrawing our intention from the negative, that the things that we put our attention on are the things that we can manifest in power. And so we're trying to create a community where we support one another, where we take out the competition. So one of the things I was going to ask you is, you know, if we can't move into one of the new earth nation communities, how can we really support what you're doing and what the new earth is, but it's really in the hearts of humanity?
I love this question. I love this question because it really brings us to the heart of it. It's not about moving into a new earth community. It's about manifesting it. And you see, there's the beautiful distinction that the New Earth Haven, the first flagship, opens here in Bali in a few weeks' time. That's why I'm here, and a great many of our team are here. So our flagship New Earth Haven is opening here in physicality. People can fly here, come and stay here, and see and touch and feel it. And we're building out a number of New Earth Haven flagships in different parts of the world. And on the Midsummer's Day this year, we have a day-long festival being planned in Bali where we're going to be unveiling the other New Earth flagships in all continents, in point of fact. And wow. that'll become public knowledge, and people can go and later this year into next year variously and spend time and connect with those flagship New Earth havens. The greater New Earth communities are going to be growing off the havens. The havens are the seeding. We're building restaurants and internet cafes and a few bio-architected dwellings and domes for people to come and see and touch and feel this bio-resonant, bio-architected, permacultured environment that we're creating, where the whole system integrates into a more or less pattern of perfection that we are tangibly manifesting. That's what the havens are. And we have our own apothecary launching with our own cures and our own treatments that are all bioresonant and fully organic and fully integrated whole systems approach to nutrition, to health, to wellness. We're launching in summer the New Earth clothing line, the label, with bioresonant fabrics sourced from different parts of the world. All of this stuff is taking our expression to where it should be. I'll give you an example. Yeah. People, by wearing the clothes that we're wearing, are killing ourselves. The false non-vegetable dyes that our clothes are dyed in are chemical toxins. Through skin impedance and the sweat molecules, they're being assimilated into the bloodstream and are causing mutant cellular structures, i.e. cancers. So we're poisoning ourselves with the clothes that we wear, with the shampoo that we use, with the eye drops we use, yes, with the food that is genetically modified, with the badly architected rooms and homes and buildings that we live in, these built environments which are all surrounded with mutant electrical values, which are causing subtle interventions into our cellular structures through electrical radiation. And so it goes on. And that's not even speaking to the fact that the soil has been poisoned by our goddamn governments. Endemically poisoned. The water, the soil and the air are being endemically and systemically poisoned by our own governments. Those creatures that are mandated to serve, protect, and defend us are the things doing the poisoning and the genocidal actions. So in that mutant dystopian environment, it behooves human beings who are somewhat conscious to step the hell out of that mythos, to withdraw the invisible contract known as the birth registration and the passports and all of that, and say thank you, no thank you. You are now a privately owned corporation masquerading as a government. You are serving central bankers and Babylonian priests. You do not serve living men and women. You are no longer mandated to be my authority. I withdraw my consent. That's called law, Mary Lou. All of us are entitled to do that. In fact, we are supposed to, if we're even remotely conscious, we're supposed to withdraw our consent from the creature that is destroying us and our children.
Yes. Oh, so true. So true. And I love the way you put it. You know what? I wanted to ask you another question. There's something happening, I feel like, in the hearts of humanity today that's enabling people to transcend all of these things and really see past these illusions, past this time-space illusion, and really tap into something transcendental, a realm that is beyond that. I traveled through Europe this summer, and it seems like people all over the globe, something is happening. What do you see happening?
I understand absolutely what you're saying and why you're saying it, because for me, this is also very palpable. I've also felt this very strongly. More so, I have to say, tiptoeing into 2016, more so than last year, and last year more so than 2014. So I would agree fully that unless we're entirely deluded, which is possible, it seems to me that we are moving into a whole new paradigmatic shift. And it's taking place at the very subtle level, at the most subtle level. It's a beautiful thing. I mean, I speak to some extent on the astronomical and astrophysical and astrological aspect to this shift that is taking place. And it is connected to the end of a yuga, to the 2012-2013 crossover point, which itself speaks to an astrophysical phenomena and an astronomical phenomena taking place in this quadrant of the manifest universe, where that great big galactic breath of God, or breath of Allah the Compassionate, that issues from the black hole in the Milky Way, the photon band, is something which we have impacted recently. This is the transition between the Piscean into the Aquarian age. Right. And it happened 13,000 years ago at the time of the Great Deluge, when the world was not equal to an upgrade and went into cataclysm with the Great Deluge and the apocryphal Noah and the Ark story emerged off the back of that. Most, if not all, ancient cultures and cosmologies speak to the 13,000 years in the past, when the entire surface of the earth appeared to have been covered at one point in water, or as near as dammit. So we know that there is this extraordinary 13,000 year passage that we have just broken through into the galactic day, out of the galactic night, and that this speaks to a greater cycle of time, the grand procession of the equinox, a 26,000 year cycle of linear time. And all of this is encoded in reality. It's the fact that we have moved through that photon band and are moving through it now simply tells us that we're being bombarded by this extraordinary cloud of vibral light, which is in and of itself impacting the atomic structure of every organic form on this plane. And so we are being lit up from the inside, literally, by these photons. And this is what's causing the mask to drop, and the falling away, the bifurcation in alchemical terms. It's a very beautiful process, and a very organic one, actually.
Mm-hmm. And what's amazing is that so many of our ancient ancestors talked about this day, didn't they? I mean, the Mayans, we know how the Mayan calendar was really a new beginning, talking about what is happening, and the Hopi Indians. So many of those ancient texts have really pointed to where we're living. So for me, I'm really expecting, and I have an inner knowing that humanity is coming out of the illusion and really waking up right now, which really gives us so much hope for such a future that we are really seeing past this illusion. But another thing I wanted to ask you was, you know, Sasha, I've heard you often talk about the Babylonian priesthood. And for those who don't know what you're talking about, I would like for you to kind of explain what you are referring to when you talk about the Babylonian priesthood.
Sure. It's not an object. It's not a discrete object that one can point at. It is a cumulative phenomenon, in as much as the egregious element that emerges in the temporal plane and ends up devouring humanity is always that aspect of the collective unconscious that has not been assimilated or brought into light through the transmutation of the human conscious action. Meaning to say, where we do not place our attention and cast light, shadows emerge, and then group shadows emerge, and then collective patterns of imperfection tend to aggregate. And they aggregate ultimately and invite lower astral entities or intelligences into the temporal realm. And this is where so-called demonic possession is invited by us into our field of expression. And the weaker elements amongst the human family are subject to that interposition and to that takeover, to those walk-ins, to that possession. And where that occurs, it generally happens in areas of confluenced power, money, control. Because wherever there is a need to seek power or control or wealth or fame, we are dealing there with a shadow element within the gestalt, or within the individual conscience. So that's what ultimately manifests into our reality field. And it creates a culture of negativism, and invariably emerges through religions and cultures and civilizations, and ruling elites tend to emerge and co-opt the capacity to control humanity and harvest humanity. So in my language, the Babylonian priesthood is that that archonic intelligence or the lower vibral intelligence which manifests into our realm, one way or the other infiltrates the corridors of power and ends up driving the trajectory of our civilizations. It's happened time and time and time again. So the Vatican, for instance, I will speak to that, the Vatican conspiracy, which one can mathematically work out according to fractal mathematics. In the last 500 years, essentially, the Vatican has been a confounded miasm of very egregious and nefarious action. It has not served humanity, it has served false light. The papal bulls of discovery that were implemented 500 years ago by the seal of the Bishop of Rome, by the Pope himself, designated all brown skin, yellow skin, red skin, and black skin humans as being homo animalis, subhumans, animals. And it, he gave the license to the French, Portuguese, Spanish, and English at that time to go forth and conquest and destroy the fabric of this world and genocide and murder hundreds of millions of souls of our brothers and sisters. So a huge sacrifice of innocence was undertaken under the aegis, in fact, the direct instruction of Rome in the last 500 years. Let's not kid ourselves. Sacrifice of innocence, genocide, pandemonium, evil of the highest order of magnitude. And that was where we didn't even see it. Where we saw it in our own culture was within the Inquisitions, the purges, these godless, disgusting, diabolical actions by the Vatican and by the Roman Catholic Church, and not just by them, by a great many other religious factions as well. So my point being, why do we still convince ourselves that some silly old man wearing a white robe and a skull cap poncing around in St. Peter's Square is serving humanity? No, he's not serving humanity. The sooner there is a wholesale dissolution of the Roman Catholic Church in that context, and a releasing of the sequestered information and wisdom in the vaults of the Vatican, giving back to the people the true learning, the true knowledge of ages, that would be serving humanity. Giving back the stolen wealth and gold of humanity, that would be serving humanity. And yet all we see is the controlled demolition of the church. It's a very slow process right now. Nonetheless, I'm sorry, I've gone off on a tangent there. But the Babylonian priesthood, in that sense, I'm afraid, is the existing Jesuitical order that drives the vaults of the Vatican and the Roman Catholic Church, and drives also the corporation governments of the world through the Bohemian Grovers and the Bilderbergers, the Council of Foreign Relations, the Royal Institute for International Affairs, the United Nations, the Security Council of the UN in particular, Brussels, the European Union, the multilateral associations of the world that are driving the globalist agenda are the de facto Babylonian priesthood, whether they know it or not. I sit down and speak to a great many leaders in these factions, including in the Vatican and these royal households and so on. And I am well aware of the fact that the majority of operatives in these corridors of power haven't the faintest idea what they're engaged with. They're simply pen pushers. They're doing what they're told to do or mandated to do with their briefings. But the greater picture is that they are, all of them, functionaries in a sacrifice of innocence and the harvest wheel of humanity. Because the Vatican, the Crown of England, the International Monetary Fund, the Bank of International Settlements, the World Bank, the International Finance Corporation, the 197 corporation governments driven by their central reserve banks are all part of the same collective monstrous oligarchy that is driven by a Babylonian agenda. And the agenda systemically seeks the harvest of humanity. It is why we have more wars on earth today than at any time in the history of the world, despite the Second World War coming out of it and the United Nations being sold to the world as being the great big agenda that would never see another war and would harmonize all nations and cultures. The hell it did. All that was a franchise of the League of Nations, which was a franchise of the Cecil John Rhodes Roundtables, which was a franchise of satanic and Saturnian agendas dreamt up 200-300 years ago under the Lurian Kabbalists of the Levitate Sphi and Adam Weishaupt and a number of other historical figures. These are all the Babylonian priesthood. Mm-hmm. So the Director General, Secretary General of the United Nations, is a functionary of the Babylonian priesthood. I've always said that these individuals who are actually sitting at the front, the Director Generals or the Secretary Generals or the Commanders in Chief, invariably themselves are puppets. They invariably wake up in the morning and look in the mirror and ask, how the hell did I get to become president or king or whatever? And they're engineered into play. But right behind them, invariably, you have the driving hand, in much the same way that we know that Ronald Reagan was driven by George Bush Sr., who is a highly nefarious and egregious creature. The Bush family, well-evidenced pathology of high crimes, murderous agendas within the crime Clinton-Bush crime cartel. Obama is absolutely interwoven into that. Make no mistake about that. So we have a highly egregious criminal cartel has co-opted the American government. And the British government is no better, that's for sure. Occasionally, we get an outsider like Jeremy Corbyn or Bernie Sanders who may be swept in on a popular vote and be highly compromised by the status quo. But Mary Lou, the Babylonian priesthood is the creature that has aggregated and continues to aggregate around power, wealth, and control, and ensures its ownership of power, wealth, and control through the systemic harvest of innocence. That harvesting of innocence is played out in the war zones of the world and in the genocidal agendas being driven by the Gates Foundation and by other venerable institutions that people think are great and good benefactors and humanitarian institutions. They are nothing like it. They are generational Luciferian agendas that are playing out in the 21st century. And our good common human heart and the good nature that we generally have is responsible for permissioning it.
Yes. And you know, what's really interesting, we're getting ready to have an election here in America. And very few people know that almost all of our presidents, their lineage goes back to either the throne of England or Charlemagne. Almost all of our presidents. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens. And not only that, I saw a picture of all of the people in Congress and the Senate and how they really are all related in some ways. 10th cousins, and so there is this connection. And I think about Washington, the Vatican, and London, that Trinity that is all controlled by the Vatican. Yes. So what you're saying is so true, but I love the way you put it and explain that Babylonian priesthood, that people sometimes don't really see that connection, that there really is such a underground. But let me ask you this, Sasha, do you see that this bondage that we've been under is beginning to break up?
There's no question about that. Again, it's breaking up for galactic reasons, Mary Lou. Yeah. There is a dissolution process underway at the galactic level. There is a bifurcation taking place at the supradimensional level of our reality expression. So that bifurcation is a paring away of the light from the dark, so that that which is light infused becomes known to itself, and that which is absent in light becomes known to all. The mask is falling away, and covert agendas can no longer remain covert. It's why we're seeing an exponential rise in whistleblowers coming out, exponential rate in cancers and people dying, because there are certain forms that cannot withstand and unnecessarily electing at the soul level just to peel off. You know, this old Jesuitical, Zionist, Khazarian grotesquerie that has been driven in the modern domain or modern context by the Brzezinski, Soros, Kissinger, Bush cartel, which has really sought to bring about ultimately a return to the throne of Solomon and the rebuilding of the Temple of Solomon in Israel under the shield of Satan, the red shield, or the Rothschild, and that's connected to the 1776 induction of the Illuminati by Adam Weishaupt, and again the Lurian Kabbalistic agenda that underpins that. People have to get very savvy and really get to grips with history if they want to understand the true scope. Pundits like me come along and speak and drop words and little bombs here and there in what we say, and people go, oh my God, what's he talking about? You know, just dropping these awful memes and ideas. I've done the graft. I've really gone into it. I've followed not so much the written word as the intuitive narrative. I've navigated that, and I've more or less arrived at a whole system's understanding of the Saturnian or Luciferian agenda. I have a very clear idea in my own heart and mind about how the Luciferian agenda came about and how it has served. This is the key thing. Without that Luciferian agenda, we would not have been served in such a way as to self-reflect and to arrive at this,
right,
at this awakening point. So everything serves. In that context, what we need to do is simply acknowledge that everything ultimately is a pattern of perfection. Everything, right, ultimately that manifests on our radar screen in life is absolutely mandated by us. Me, Sasha Stone, whatever occurs to me. I remember, right, having a motorcycle accident a few years ago, and I remember time slowing down. And instead of filtering out and denying the experience, I saw it through the eyes of a child, and it slowed time down. And I was very connected experientially into the motorcycle accident in such a way that I could move out of the way, and the head didn't impact the tarmac, because one was present. One was attentive in the now, even in an ugly situation. And I think increasingly that if we don't view ourselves as victims, but view every event, every circumstance in life as being a perfect unfoldment, which if we are present in that unfolding petal, will take us into the highest expression and take us out of the low forms of our fated expression, because one can always override fate by imposing a higher pattern upon it. But you can only do it if you completely withdraw from victimhood and stop blaming anything or anyone outside of self for whatever occurs. Absolutely vital.
Yeah. You know, I so agree with you. You know, I think that is such a key for us to take responsibility. What we're seeing in the world is really the corporate consciousness too, to a degree. I mean, when we change ourselves and withdraw from victimhood and really begin to love and step out of competition and support other people, we're going to see a change in the whole consciousness of humanity. It's that butterfly effect. So I think that was a great point. Let me ask you a question though. I think that a lot of people are wondering what is happening globally to our currency today. What do you see happening?
Well, you know, I'm about to publish a book on the 14th of February. It's the first proper book that Humanitad is putting out. It's called The Bankster Diaries. It's written by Ambassador James Bernard Gilmore. He is a remarkable soul in his early 80s. Who has spent 25 years assembling the evidences and has written the ultimate expose on the Federal Reserve, exposing the Federal Reserve and the criminal conspiracy behind the extant global financial system. In that book, The Bankster Diaries, the entire pathology is laid out of how we've arrived at what we've arrived at. We can talk till we're blue in the face about the different scenarios that we're facing, Mary Lou, in respect of global economics. And I'm not sure that it's going to serve us to do so. The United States dollar is in free fall already. In point of fact, it's already collapsed. It just, rather like 2012, 2013, we crossed over that Rubicon and moved outside of the remit of time. And the lords of time no longer have any thrall over us. But our collective, the fact that we're still collectively somewhat asleep and only blinking into the dawn means that we still believe in the idea of time. And we're still collectively allowing the falsity of time to govern the world, albeit we are no longer within the thrall of time. In the same way, we have already moved beyond catastrophic failure of the global economy. It's already occurred. It just hasn't quite hit the tarmac in San Diego yet, or in Milano, or in Birmingham. And that's about to happen, no question. The next 2-3 years is when the rubber hits the road and people in the Western, the more comfortable nation states and cityscapes will begin to see how that has played out, how us being indentured generations into the future by our central reserve banks who have been in fraud and treason against the people, hand in glove with the governments, how the governments and the central banks are actually the same creature, and that the whole business of currency has been the greatest myth of all. What is currency? I can tell you what currency is. It's the totem of the devil. That's all it ever is. That's all it ever was. It is how false light or Luciferianism became accreted into a physical totem and then put into the palm of our hands. And we were then invited into trading value with these false totems and believing that having that stuff in the pocket meant something. Actually, it means nothing. It means you've got a wad of paper in your pocket. But actually, we collectively have imbued that paper with the false light interpretation of value. Even though we know it has no value, it's indentured into the future. 100 years, 200, 300 years into the future, we'll never be able to pay off the national debts, for instance. We'll never be able to pay off these godless, usurious bankers and their silly binary numbers on bits of paper or digital screens. The overbalance accounts of the central banks are where the truth of global economy exists. Most people in the world, most bankers in the world, most central bankers in the world don't even know how the global financial system works. I've sat down with White Spiritual Boy. That's the code name of the living individual who controls the black screens or the overbalance accounts. I've dealt with these figures personally in the last 3 years. The people who put the collateral up behind the global financial system hundreds of years ago. I've been dealing with Queen Salvacion Legaspi of the Philippines, with A1, M1, Sino in Indonesia, who has purposed the Indonesian gold or the Asian gold holdings. Princess Nakamaru of the Meiji imperial lineage of Japan, who's a dear friend and is part of this story. And there are other key figures. So we fundamentally got Russian land and Asian gold as two primary collaterals that are the real tangible behind the modern financial system. But the average banker, let alone central banker, knows nothing about this, knows nothing about those treaties or about the truth of it. Now, the Queen of England knows this. The Pope knows about this.
Yeah.
The Ben Bernanke and David Cohen and the IMF controllers, the European central bankers and the US Treasury Department know, and the Crown of England and the Vatican Bank, they know absolutely about these collaterals because they require the signatures of those individuals to continue perpetrating the myth of the global financial system. My point being, Mary Lou, that it is a real cluster. You know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I don't want to use profanity on your show, but it is an absolute train wreck in reality terms. And we are living by allowing Babylonians to juggle balls with the commonwealth of humanity attached as value, false value to those balls. And we don't even know where they're going to land. So why on earth are we allowing it to continue? Why are we continuing to put our attention and our permissions and allowing our birth bonds, meaning our birth certificates, to be allocated as collaterals behind that game? Because that ultimately is where the sacrifice of innocence begins, with the false registration of our children to Cronus, to the crown, to the state. Cronus is the crown. This is the titan that devours its own young. This is part of the Babylonian dream spelling that has been threaded into our reality framework whilst we were all asleep.
Right.
So currency, I can speak to you about it and say, well, you know, the US dollar is likely to fall into going to decline in Q3 of 2016, followed by the euro and the pound sterling, but it's all immaterial. There is a gypsy game going on of moving the cups around the table. And the real value is contained somewhere under one of those cups, but no one quite knows where it is. And the truth of the matter is that it's all premised on false light, on Luciferianism, false light worship. MTV is false light worship. Reading the newspapers, reading the Boston Herald and the London Times is false light worship. It is us placing our attention and our plasma on lies, deceptions, engineered into the mainframe by a criminal cartel who are rigging absolutely the education system, the entertainment that pollutes our minds, and so it goes on. At what point do you and I choose to withdraw our attention, withdraw our life force or our plasma projection from false light and put it into the soil in front of us? Put it into our communities, put it into our families, put it into our lives, ourselves, and imbue ourselves with real dignity, with real creative expansion, with real spiritual unfoldment. That's the question we should be asking. That's where the currency lies, Mary Lou, within the atom seed of the human heart and the human mind. Let us take our attention away from global currencies.
Yeah. But let me just ask you this. I agree with you thoroughly. But if people are seeing what's happening, is there some way that we can prepare for what's coming? And what are your suggestions?
Yeah. Okay, that's a different question. The first thing you can do is look in a mirror and really own one's own story in the journey, the collective journey. What part have I played? I sat down last week with some very wealthy people who are on a spiritual quest here in Bali. Very lovely couple. Very emancipated in their way, seeking only positive outcomes in life, wanting to rear a family and do good in the world with their money. Where did the money come from? It was on the back of blood economy. The money was made through hedge fund trading activities. So it's a hard one. I love the fact that many people who have made their money off the system are now plugging out of the system and wanting to repurpose that wealth. I'm not sure that money will even exist in the coming months. I believe that we're going to see an instantaneous erasure of most of that fictitious wealth because it is fiction, because it's only binary digital numbers on screens. It doesn't in and of itself exist, and there is no guarantor. Ultimately, there is no guarantor. So when the music stops and there is no chair to sit upon any longer, then what are we going to do? Howl like the banshees? Because that is the hubris that we have entertained. We have allowed that to occur. We have, each one of us, you and I, Mary Lou, have for many years been fully aware of the falsity of the global financial system. We have been fully aware of the falsity of paying to income taxes. We have, yeah, nonetheless, because of our fear reflexes, we have each of us variously paid into that false light nonetheless. Well, payday is upon us. Now, what can we do to repurpose our lives sooner than later? I would suggest that one does what the New Earth movement has been inviting people to do for the last 3 years, which is to put money such as it exists into land, into arable land in the first instance. That's essential, into a place where one can grow food and build home, build community, and then engage in the right kind of built environments based on permaculture principles, bioarchitecture principles, zero-point microgrid principles. This is much of the know-how and knowledge transfer which the New Earth Nation is offering people variously through the Institute. And people can always write to me or any of the team, and we can also knowledge share that way. But I would suggest that if people are serious about the business of protecting wealth insofar as they have it, I would suggest the sooner they take it out of fiction banks, the better, because it's sitting in, wallowing in banks, paying into that system, and will just as soon disappear off the screens when it suits the Jesuits. And it will happen that way. There are different games going on at different levels, but I don't believe that anyone knows what the outcome is going to be. I think it's in a real state of flux right now. So how do we engage navigating through flux, Mary Lou? We do it using our highest authority, which is our intuitive navigation system. And we don't listen to the head, and we don't listen to the heart, because the heart is emotional. It's attached to objects. It's attached to people and places and relationships, and is affected as a result. And similarly, our brain is attached to ideas, and ideas are invariably dead anyway. So I would suggest the best thing for people to do is to navigate intuitively and purpose what money they do have toward that which is real, which is humans and land, community and arable land, and begin to actually manifest something that is real. Grow potatoes, just start to really connect with this living soil, because as the great Babylonian fiction crashes to the ground in the days ahead, all that will be left standing is that which is real, and that which exists outside of those fictitious realms. And those will be living men and women of the living soil. And there'll be many of us, Mary Lou, many of us flourishing and thriving at the time that the Tower of Babel collapses.
Beautiful. And that's really what New Earth Nation is about, isn't it? And Michael Tellinger talk about a moneyless society. I know both of you are really talking. How does that work, Sasha, for people that maybe have not seen that?
Very simply put, you get a land holding, you get the land owner or the land holder to purpose the land towards the community. You get people to engage in forming that community. You bring in plumbers, electricians, master builders, dentists, child care experts. You bring in animal caretakers. You bring in farmers. You bring in people of the world who can all purpose their attention toward a given community objective, where they can freely exchange their skills and their resources and their time and their energy, but not for money. And you see where you find a dentist. And we found dentists who don't want to make money off dentistry, but they want to continue practicing dentistry. So they, for instance, are bringing New Earth Dentistry. We're actually creating a franchise of New Earth Dentistry, which we'll be putting out shortly. So for instance, you just engage relationship with people sufficiently to sit around and talk and create the right kind of skills and resources that you need for a given community. They all move in there. So the master builder starts the business of building the homes for those people, knowing as he does that he and his family are going to be living in that community and getting free dental care and eating the fruits of the land, which are going to be grown by the farmer who's coming in and bringing his farming expertise in. It's about relationship, Mary Lou. It's not complicated. When we stop buying into the fiction and walking out of our front doors in the morning with suitcase, with briefcases and suits and ties, the hangman's noose around our neck, and cuffs and skirts and high heels and all the falsity that comes with the contraptions that come with a false light, indentured reality, and get back to relationship.
Yeah.
And meet real people and connect our hearts and minds. My God, we can build these communities in no time at all. And they can be protected under their own law. The International Tribunal that we set up is a new court. It's already ratified under multilateral observance. It exists. It's already undertaken directions hearings, and trials are being slated. We've even got government departments of countries, two countries, have approached us and are wanting to have hearings within our tribunal because they can't get satisfaction in their own supreme courts. What does that tell you?
Right.
Times are changing. Things are changing. But we need to reconnect. A community of people who are all inputting their skills, their resources, their talents, but not for money, is how you reach a cashless society in the shortest possible time. So what we're doing right now, up the road from where I'm sitting in the New Earth Haven. We've got a whole host of people who are working towards a common goal. They're each of them very expert in what they do. And we're all inputting and manifesting and building something out of the ground. And it's beautiful. It is a beautiful haven that is infused with art and beauty and consciousness. One doesn't need to go completely low tech in a cashless environment. Now, the truth of the matter is that we are inviting people to come in from the real world and to spend real money in these communities to pay into it so that we can grow out the land holdings and continue to build out the actual cooperative, because we are creating havens as a transition between the existing reality matrix and the full zero-point New Earth communities. The zero-point communities will ultimately emerge once we have released free energy technology into the grids. And I'm happy to be the one to say that on middle of June this year, we are making a bold pronouncement. The lighting, heating, irrigation, all of the energy need that is coming into the community here is going to be issuing at no cost. That in itself, Mary Lou, has just eradicated 90% of the need for money. Because money, as you know, goes toward heating, lighting, communication, transport, fundamental energy consumption is where the overarching bulk of our money goes to anyway. So do you get the picture now? How the Babylonian priesthood and our own collective unconsciousness has permissioned a civilization to emerge, which harvests us into the false notion of needing to do jobs in order to pay, earn money, in order to pay bills, in order to destroy the environment, in order to plunder resources and blow them up into false electricity and sell that electricity utility back to us in transportation, communication, lighting, heating, agriculture, and so on. This is the false light paradigm is anchored by false energy.
Right.
And once we have free energy or cold electrical energy coming in, this is the Tesla, Schauberger, Velikovsky element of science, not the Cartesian, Newtonian, Einsteinian model of science, which is invariably a bullshit element. There are elements of truth to Newton's science and to the Cartesian model and to the Einsteinian model, but in the main, they are utterly redundant. The Steiner aspect of reality is what we need to start to engage and move ourselves fully into the quantum domain, which is where, incidentally, we become well because we think of ourselves as well. Where we become prosperous because we think ourselves prosperous and abundant. Where we unhook our minds and hearts and our plasma projection from false light, from the values of scarcity that have been sold to us by the goddamn Vatican and the Crown of England and the corporations masquerading as governments and the bank and media cartels that sell us apocalypse, sell us Armageddon, sell us these notions of ecological destruction and decay and entropic values. We are not living in an entropic universe that is predisposed towards decay and cold and death. We are actually living in a vibrant quantum reality, which is limitless, ineffable, boundless, immortal, so long as we place our attention in that space.
Beautiful, beautiful. Well, I have enjoyed this, and I tell you, you give us so much hope, Sasha, just hearing what's happening with these New Earth nations, and that I know that our community, we've gone to your website and signed up and joined because we want to support this vision, and it just gives us so much hope for a future. And like you said, everything is within us, and when we begin to see that we have everything within us, we become sovereign. And I just posted something you had on your Facebook page about the meaning of sovereignty on our Facebook page today. And I thought it was so beautiful. A slave no longer.
Wonderful.
And that's exactly what you're talking about. For us to come out and really be sovereign and know that our beingness, what we started with, that you said instead of doing, you are really stepping into being. And I think that's where we are today. Really becoming sovereign and knowing that we have all of divinity within ourselves, to change everything and put our focus on what's positive. Is there anything that you would like to say as we're closing?
We would love it if you guys could beam in live and participate on the big screen on the day-long New Earth Festival we're doing here in Bali on Midsummer's Day.
I'll get with Marie and definitely plan that. Thank you so much, Sasha. And we really support you and all of your team and what you're doing. And we're holding the vision here in America. And that's our vision, too, to connect with other people of like minds around the world, that we can really empower one another. And it's all about relationships. That's what you said. And
amen, we believe to that.
Thank you so much.
God bless you.
God bless you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.